Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel. So today, Kanishka and I will be filming a recap of the 2019 US National Figure Skating Championships that happened in Detroit. And by now, that was a week ago, so I apologize that this is going up later than usual. But we all need a break from skating in life sometimes. And since it's been a bit of a while, Kanishka, I was hoping we can make this video more of a discussion-style conversation rather than thoroughly going over the results of each competitor. Because to all of you viewers watching, we have to remember that all of the athletes that showed up to Detroit for Nationals already had a successful season because they qualified by competing at regionals and sectionals or their placement at nationals the year before or competing at a senior international Grand Prix event. So congratulations to all the athletes if they're possibly watching this. But Kanishka, since we filmed a pairs preview together a month ago, I figured we could start out there. And kudos to Ashley Kane and Tim LeDuc for winning their first national title. Such great news to hear because they really deserved it with both of their skates in the short and in the free. And also as an extra bonus, I'm super grateful that Timothy LeDuc becomes the first openly out gay man to win a pairs national title. That is a big deal. If you follow him on social media, which is mostly Facebook, he's really outspoken about social justice issues, which you and I can both appreciate. But let's focus on the skating. That was good. The free skate is what won it for them. Side-by-side triple loops, so difficult, and they really performed, especially in the second half of that free skate. They absolutely deserved the title, in my opinion. What do you think?
Totally agree. Yeah, first of all, congratulations to Ashley and Tim for putting out two outstanding performances at the Nationals this year. And I know United States Figure Skating has that hashtag that goes around every year, get up, and I feel like Ashley and Tim epitome that statement, especially after the events that took place in Croatia just a month earlier. And I couldn't be more proud of those two, having followed their career since they debuted at Nationals, and I know how hungry and determined they were this season to win the national title. And as Tara Lipinski, the commentator for NBC Sports, said, like, they wanted to win this national title, and they came so hungry and determined and motivated, and the training really did stack up to how they performed here. And again, I could not be more proud of them, and I look forward to seeing them competing at four continents in a couple weeks and then Worlds. Like, so proud of you guys if you guys are watching, and couldn't be more prouder than right now. So, congratulations.
That's right. So, I think a lot of people had kind of written them off or did not predict they would win this year because of the bad accident in Croatia in early to mid-December. But it sounds like, by listening from all the interviews that Ashley and Tim gave to the press, that might have been a blessing in disguise. Obviously, Ashley had to take some time away from the ice. She was in a neck brace, and they had to come back slowly but steadily. And Tim LeDuc had even said many times that they had to take it one element at a time. I'm wondering if that played a part in making them so mentally strong to be able to compete as well as they did to win the title, because the pairs were all going at it.
It was quite the competition here. Yeah, like it could have gone either way, really.
But no injury can set you back. Ash Kane and Tim LeDuc will tell you that. And I will say also a surprise finish here at Nationals would be the silver medal winners here. So it's Haven Denny and Brandon Fraser. I think a lot of people, maybe myself included, had written them off just because they've been plagued with injuries. I think Haven tends to have the injuries, so they're not always consistent, especially on their side-by-side jumps. And usually when they are clean, I feel like the judges usually don't reward them with higher program component marks just because of their history. But they skated pretty well considering their past competitions. And it was really great to see Haven so emotional after their programs. I haven't seen them so happy in a really long time. So kudos to them.
Yeah, like I'm friends with Brandon Fraser on Facebook. So I saw like a week or two before Nationals, they were posting their practices and they were growing a lot stronger than like we were expecting. Because I think that when we filmed the Paris preview, we did not see any of those clips. So, after seeing those clips, I wish I could have just changed back time and been like, hey, they're coming on strong. But as a fan of figure skating, like, we love comebacks, you know? And, again, like, I could not be prouder of a team that just, like, continues to fight and keeps coming back despite injury. And, hey, I don't think anyone predicted a silver medal for them, but I know for one fact that they do have a lot of supporters on Twitter and social media. And who knows? This could be the, like, rising from the ashes for Haven and Brendan, though. So
that's right. We believe they're going to four continents. Yes, they are. So that's another chance to gain some world points. And I think they reworked some of their technique. Their twist has never looked so good and high. Wow, if you want to watch anything, watch their, like, throw triple twist in both the short and the long. And, you know, the side-by-side jumps are still an issue, but they managed to stay on their feet for the most part. I think there were still some landing issues with them, but, you know, baby steps, and I'm really proud of them. I'm also super proud of the winners of the bronze medal here. You know, one of my favorites, Deanna Stellato-Dudek and Nathan Bartholomé. They had to come from behind a little bit, but that free skate to the Whitney Houston number, oh, Deanna Stellato was giving us so much face on the second half of that free skate. Some people might say it's too much face. I read the Twitter comments. Not me. I'm sorry. Figure skating is all about putting your emotions out there. She's so intense. She took so much time off of skating, and now she's back. Like, she's going to wear her heart on her sleeve. Obviously, I don't think they scored as high as they should have. One can argue that they weren't perfect. Deanna had a grit and fight for a lot of those landings, but they were landed. They stayed on their feet. You know, were they as smooth as some of the other pairs? No, but they rightfully earned the bronze medal. And then I want to ask your question about this. I'm pretty upset because they're not being sent to four continents, which the U.S. has three spots for. Instead, the winners of the pewter medal, Tara Kane and Danny O'Shea, are going instead. You know my opinion. What is yours?
I wish I could say I don't have an opinion on this because I love them both. However, like, I can see why someone would be disappointed. I know that Jim Peterson was pretty disappointed. I think there was an article that came out earlier this week where Jim Peterson was pretty shocked, to say the least, that Deanna and Nate were not sent to four continents despite winning a bronze medal. But that's the weird thing about the criteria that goes into international assignments within not just United States figure skating, but just any sport nowadays. And when they look at body of work, I guess Tara and Danny are the reigning four continents champions, and then they also won a silver medal at the Grand Prix that they were in France, I believe. So all of those things apparently went into consideration for who got selected for four continents. So it kind of seems a little bit justified, but on the same end, like, as a fan of Deanna and Nate myself, like, I feel like it must be a big disappointment or like a dagger to the heart where you put out the best performance you can and you were able to win a bronze medal. And they thought that that would give them at least a trip to four continents. And now their season is practically over. And you could argue both ways. And again, I feel the disappointment that Deanna and Nate are going through. But at the same time, I really wish the best for Tara Kane and Danny O'Shea on their trip to four continents this year.
Wow, you're so PC and nice. I guess I'm such a big Deanna fan that I'm like, she was a rob. No, but in my defense, I don't think, let's be honest, that was kind of a controversial decision.
I see. Yep.
And, you know, it's not like it's the Olympics or Worlds. It's four continents. Like, send, you know, the top three from nationals. That's my opinion. I don't think either team is far more consistent than the other. I've heard other people saying that Tara Kane and Danny O'Shea have higher scoring potential in both technical and program components. But, you know, they also suffer from, like, bad mistakes, like fluke mistakes happening in international competitions as well. So, you know, if they're cleaner, sure, they could score bigger, but they're not always clean. So, I don't know. I feel for Deanna, but, you know, Ashley and Tim are going to Worlds. That's the big decision. I'm glad that wasn't controversial. I'm just wondering why they made the interesting decision for the four continents. But you do bring up some valid points, but I'm still heartbroken.
I agree, yeah, especially because, like, you would think that the bronze medalist, especially in an off-Olympic year, should be selected for four continents. And I feel like we love Deanna. I think that the United States love, like, the skating fans, we love Deanna, and we like that comeback story of, like, a 30-some-year-old coming back after in a total different discipline, you know? Like, we did that with like a few years, not few years, but like many years ago now. And yeah, it's just heartbreaking. And I hope that Jim Peterson, their coach, knows that there's still a lot of people that are supporting them and obviously feel the same way that he is right now. But maybe this will be a blessing in disguise as well. You know, maybe they'll train harder. They'll back next year much stronger.
They have a longer training season.
There's still 3 years until the next Olympics, so.
Yeah, and Ashley and Tim, please get us two spots again, which I think can happen because and I want to discuss this, because in the press conference after the Paris Free, Deanna Stellato graciously took the mic and reminded us that Germany had qualified two pair spots at Worlds next year, but Aliona and Bruno won't be competing, so they're low-level pairs. This is the time to do well at Worlds. And really, any of the top American pairs has as good of a chance as before to be in that top 10. So Ashley and Tim, you could do this. I also wanted to say that I thought it was kind of rude that the reporters, and it sounds like this happened in a lot of disciplines, it seems like most of the questions are always geared towards the winner of the competition. Now, I understand why they may get the most, but I also think it's kind of offensive not to ask any questions to the other medal winners up there. Like, the skaters just all gave their opening statements, and then one reporter after the other just kept asking questions to the champion. And I really think something else needs to happen. Like, that it shouldn't be that way. Like, you know, reporters should be interested in all athletes up there. That's something I wanted to get on record.
I totally agree with you. Like, these are athletes who all want the equal share of attention. You know, that's part of sport. And I totally agree with you, Justin, that they need to ask questions to the others. Like, you could have came up with so many questions for either Haven and Brandon, Tara and Danny, and all, obviously, Deanna.
Although and Tara and Danny weren't there.
They weren't there because they were fourth, yeah.
Yeah.
In the short program, right? Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So they could have asked a lot of questions. There's so many. Maybe it's because, like, the news reporters don't know skating as much as we do.
Mm-hmm.
So they don't know what to ask.
Yeah.
But, hey, it's time to get on the skating bandwagon again.
So maybe some fans can, like, get some press passes and ask some questions.
Yeah, it's like not all the reporters know skating as much. But that's the truth with journalists, right? Like, they don't always have the same expertise that us skating fans or the certain Jackie Wongs that are on the press conference know. So
that's right.
We'll see what happens in the future, but I totally agree with you, though.
Okay, great. So before we wrap up with the pairs, let's discuss just a few more things. So obviously, Tara Kane and Danny O'Shea, they really lost that bronze medal because of that free skate. It was the last lift that really did it. It looked like it could have been from an injury, but I think after hearing reports afterwards, that wasn't the case. It was just a positioning problem. So that's that. And then there is Alexa Skemeka-Knierim and Chris Knierim finishing way down in, what was it? Yeah, it looks like they're seventh overall. Not impressive. Short, long. Actually, the long was very, very hard to watch because they had to dismount two lifts. I'm not sure if dismount is the right word to say. Some of them just really couldn't get up there. Side-by-side jumps were off. Even the short program, the throw triple twist was not caught properly. Something's going on with Chris's wrist, so that's unfortunate. So I just hope they can heal up okay in the off season.
Yeah, totally agree. Like, it was kind of shocking because I think that when we did the Paris predictions, like, we had Alexa and Chris up there as far as at least the silver medal goes, if not Tara and Danny. I think you had Alexa and Chris winning, right?
Mm-hmm.
So. I wonder how serious of an injury this wrist injury is, because I don't think it was ever talked about until NBC reported it afterwards.
Right.
So that made me question a lot of different things. Mm-hmm. But hopefully it's not serious, and hopefully this time away from competing will allow them to reassess exactly what they want to do, whether it's to continue competitive skating, whether it's to have a baby, because I know Alexa has mentioned in the past that she wants to have a child and whatnot, because they have accomplished a lot already. They've accomplished an Olympic medal. They've been to many world championships, and they won multiple national championships. So, and they won an Olympic medal. I'm not sure if I already said that. I'm sorry if I already did.
No,
but it's okay. So they accomplished a lot in their career. So it's maybe not going to Worlds this year. Maybe it'll allow them to reassess exactly what they want to get out of the next 3 years if they are planning on competing for another Olympic spot.
That's right. And to look at the bigger picture of things, it was actually really exciting watching pairs, despite the top team not really being in the mix. I know a lot of us, including myself, like to cry about the current state of American pairs. But when you watch the free programs, especially that last group, you think, wow, this is a great competition. The thing we have to remember is that our pairs usually bring it at nationals. It's when they're off at international competitions when we're like, ooh, yeah, you know, we need to get it together. But we do have the potential there. I know I hate saying that word, but I'm going to use that anyways. We do have pair skaters with the ability to land on the podium at Grand Prix. It just takes consistency.
And speaking of potential, Justin, mm-hmm. do you have the results in front of you? Because I'm getting a team. Can you tell me who was fourth here, I think, or fourth or fifth?
So you're probably thinking of fifth, which is Jessica Callalang and Brian Johnson. Yes. I did see them, and I like the way they look on the ice.
I do too, yeah. They had separate partners last year at U.S. Nationals, and all of a sudden they got together, and they mesh very well, and they can do side-by-side jumps.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the commentators on NBC actually mentioned that, and that has held us back so many years. If they could come on and be consistent in that part of the game and really push the levels of their lifts, which are very important, obviously, in the pairs discipline, I can really see them, like, being a top team in the future because they have all that potential.
Let's start with the most important thing, which is land the side-by-side jumps. So they got that from the beginning. Take your time gelling as a pair.
Exactly.
Okay, so I think we're free to move on to another discipline. Let's go with men's, because Nathan Chen, wow. Not only did he do a three-peat, I've always wanted to use that word. That we don't always get to use that word with the national championship. So Nathan Chen has won the gold medal for the third time in the row. And not only did he win, he won with so many more points over everybody else. His total program score, competition score actually, was 342.22. Next up was Vincent Zhou with 284.01. Like, that is a ridiculous gap. Now, I do want to take this moment to acknowledge to everybody, yes, inflation of scores happens at nationals. It just does. Now, what we don't always discuss in figure skating communities, Kanishka, is whether or not that's a healthy thing for our skaters. You know, we know it happens, Canada, Russia, United States, but, you know, does it set up, like, false expectations for when our skaters go compete internationally? You know, or does it allow, like, journalists who don't know, like, all the details of our sport, like, compare our national scores with, like, Nathan's with Yuzu Ruhanyu's and be like, oh, Nathan can easily beat Yuzu with this score. What is your take on inflation at nationals?
Inflation at nationals is pretty consistent amongst all the top countries, you know, whether it's Japan, Russia, United States, Canada, it doesn't matter where. Like, the scores will be inflated at nationals, no doubt about that. The way that journalists cover these stories is another.
Yeah.
Layer to this whole story, especially because, as I said earlier in the Paris part of this discussion, like, not all of them know skating. So in that case, like, the journalists need to really educate themselves and research, as we all do. So they know that international scores and the national scores are two different things. So in world records, you're not going to count national domestic competitions, you know? So they need to be aware of that. So when they're writing, please do the research, because otherwise you're going to get your facts wrong. And there's going to be fact checkers that are going to say you're wrong.
And they will call you out on Twitter.
They'll call you out on Twitter as you know.
Use your handle. All right. Well, let's get more into the details of the competition. Nathan Chen, how did he do it? Well, he skated perfectly clean, or as clean as he could be, you know. Some people may argue different things, but he brought back the more difficult quads because he started off the season at Skate America with watered-down content, toes, and salves. Now we're seeing quad lutz, quad flip. Short program, you know, we saw the quad flip, which was great. And then the long program, the free program, we saw the quad lutz, which, by the way, received the maximum score of grade of execution there is. All judges awarded him plus 5 grade of execution. So, I mean, that was the base value, 11.5, GOE 5.75 for a total score of 17.25 for just one jumping element, quad lutz. And from there, it went from flip, toe, triple axel. I mean, I actually thought his program component score was, you know, lots of tens, which, you know, don't get me wrong, Nathan Chen is great, but, you know, tens is kind of like, that's like saying he is absolutely where he needs to be artistically. And I actually think there's room to grow. That being said, I do love his programs. I don't think they're my most favorite, but I love them. And maybe I just love them more because they were clean.
Yeah, just to go back to your point, Justin, I think a skater like Nathan Chen would not be influenced by the inflation of scores here at U.S. Nationals. Like, he is pretty aware that the scores here at Nationals would be a lot higher than at a World Championships or even a foreign continents, where you are performing in front of international judges. So, like, he's happy with the performance that he gave, which was 2 outstanding performances for Nathan. But at the same time, he knows what he has to do in order to compete with the Hanyus and the Shomas internationally.
Or the Mikhail.
Or the Mikhail Kolyanis, if he can be consistent. And I feel bad that he is going through a rough time with his health, and that's causing him. But this is not a Europeans recap, so I won't go there. But, I think skaters like Nathan Chen are aware of the inflation of the scores that happen at U.S. Nationals, and they're kind of just being like in with one ear and out the other, and now focusing on the next competition. However, I do question Winston Zhou, but I'll let you start off with what you thought of Winston Zhou, and then I'll say what I want.
Sounds good. So to end things off with Nathan, I just wanted to say it's clear that his mind is in the right place. I mean, full-time student at Yale, training virtually with Roth over Skype. I mean, Nathan really has to take the training into his own hands, like scheduling, giving as much time. He could easily slack off when Roth is not connected by video, but clearly he isn't doing that. So kudos to Nathan. And going back to what you said, he's also well aware of Nationals inflation, and you could tell by his reaction in the kiss and cry. You know, he's not like, oh my God, that's the biggest score. He's like, that's large, okay then. which means he's taking it all with a grain of salt, which is great. So leading on to Vincent Zhou, actually surprised me quite a bit here, because I heard him say, or I read somewhere in an article, sorry I won't be able to quote the exact source, that he wanted to not attempt quads in order to skate a clean program. And then somehow that changed to, I'm coming for Nathan Chen for the title. And then he said he was attempting all the quads at Nationals. And he did. Let's just say, so he stayed on his feet. So if you like watch the program, it's fine. He had a fall in the free skate, obviously. But he got dinged, not as hard as, you know, in international competitions, but he did get dinged with the rotations on his quad jumps. Quad lutz, triple toe, opening the free program was on, but ooh, under rotation on the quad flip, quad sal, and a downgrade on the quad toe. And most of you skating fans know a downgrade is a severe penalty compared to an under rotation. But, you know, he did good enough for the silver medal here. Maybe Jason Brown gave it away by not skating his best when he didn't have a quad. But, you know, I see Vincent coming into his own skating with these programs, you know?
Yeah, the programs are coming to, like, life a little bit more than they were at Skate America when we first saw Same thing with Nathan, right? The program's been just gelling a lot more. And that's true with a lot of skaters. Like, they, as the season progresses, they just perform more easily. The only thing I question is when this program is to be translated into an international competition, how much more are they going to hamper on? Because, he is now being judged so severely where to the naked eye, it looks clean. But then when you go to an international competition, all these, carrots are there under his protocol. And, yes, there were, carrots under his protocol here as well. But it would be a lot worse. Because I remember when we watched the short program, we clearly saw it under rotation, and then it was called clean by the technical specialist. And that kind of invigorated a lot of skating experts, because they were like, it clearly under rotated and it was marked clean. So it'll be very interesting to see how he is able to translate this performance into a world competition, because it's going to be very difficult for him to stay up on the technical marks if he keeps getting these carrots. But again, he stayed on his feet for the most part. He did have one mistake in the free, but the judging this season has been really tough, and that's the only thing I question with Vincent at this point, is how is he going to rework his technique in the next 3 years so he does not have to worry about getting these under rotations and even downgrades.
Yeah, I think some skating fans are going to come for me for saying this, because a lot of people love Mariah Nagasu, but I'm thinking of this as the Mariah Nagasu effect.
Yeah, and I feel bad because I loved Mariah Nagasu as well, Beautiful skater, but yeah, she did have those issues with the under rotations. And even if you're a huge skating fan or a huge Mariah Nagasu fan, you need to understand that this, at the end of the day, is a sport, and they're going to take into account every little technical detail in order to give you the score that you deserve.
Yeah, it's a competition, not a pageant.
Exactly. That's perfectly said, Justin.
Thank you. Well, let's say Vincent was clean on all of those intended jumps with some positive GOE marks. Clearly, there's a disparity between him and Nathan Chen and Jason Brown on the program component marks. So in the free skate, Nathan Chen had a PCS of 98 and Vincent Joe had an 86. So that's, quite the drop. And I kind of agree with that. I think Nathan's is a little high, but I think Vincent's is kind of right where it needs to be. So, there is that. But, in program components, he's behind Jason Brown, who is the fan favorite. Obviously, Jason is lacking the technical content, but it is a transition year for him. I know everyone said this, but I'll just repeat it again. He now trains in Canada under Tracy Wilson or Brian Orser, which, by the way, it was really cool to see Tracy Wilson at U.S. Nationals in the Kiss and Cry with him. That was actually quite lovely to see. But I think, Jason, so he skated as good as he could, his natural ability, flexibility, his performance quality. I just wish the technical content was there.
I agree. But the thing about about Jason Brown that's very interesting is that even if he did not have a quad and he just goes clean with all the elements, his jumps are so big and they have such a nice running edge that it'll receive a positive grade of execution of at least +3, It's possible. And then he can rely on his program components to really keep him in contention. And we saw that with some of the Grand Prix that he was at, where he might not have had the quad, but he had quality with all his elements. And then obviously the program components. So a quad would be very necessary for him if he wants to be on the world podium. However, if he's just trying to go for a top 10 finish or a top 5 finish, it's really possible with his ability. However, they were reporting that he was landing a quad in practice, but from what I've heard from other skating fans, it was under-rotated.
Yes, I saw it.
So good on him for practicing it, and hopefully with time it becomes more consistent. But I feel like I have been saying that for years now.
That's true.
So I don't want to use that word consistent anymore. Instead, I just want him to just nail it and land it, so then I don't have to ever mention oh, I hope it's consistent.
Yeah,
because that makes me sound PC all the time.
Right. It's definitely a rebuilding year. success for him so far this season has been up, down, up, down. We saw with Skate Canada, it was very a down competition, and then up for the second one. This is kind of, a little in between the first two, but he was in second place, barely above Vincent Joe after the short program, and Vincent attempted two quads, whereas Jason did not. So that shows how he leads with his artistry. But let's see. At least we have three spots for Worlds. Yay! Thank you. Yes. Thank you, Nathan Chen. Well, Nathan Chen is the reigning world champion, so hopefully that's possible. Now, I hope we could talk about my surprise of Nationals. And I'm not going to lie, so I do know of the name because he's been on the scene, especially as a junior for a while, but it is Tomoki Hiwatashi. Never really watched him too much. I did know some information about him from Mai, who did the men's preview with me, and she loves men and junior men, so I got to hear about him from her, and wow, fourth place here at Nationals is a big deal. I'd say he is, I don't know how to describe him, fast, unique, not smooth, but fast, smoother than Ryan Bradley, though. Jumps are very, he attacks them really well, sometimes too much where the landings aren't great, but he grits the landing, which is actually really important to rack up the points. The thing that is really special about his performance is really that he is the unique moves that he does. So the Ina Bowers, the cantilevers, the Russian splits. Ooh, I love a perfect extension on that. And of course, he does have some work to do. He could look upwards, outwards a little more. But I just think overall he's fun. And I've watched him in interviews. He's actually quite a fun personality as well. So overall, I love Tomoki Hiwatashi. Great programs, both short and long. Watch them if you're watching this. And I'm excited because he gets to go to four continents because Nathan Chen has decided not to go, which is probably better for him to focus on studies at Yale. But this is a good opportunity for Tomoki. He can gain some world points because you don't gain them with your results at Nationals. And hopefully he gets a Grand Prix next season. Maybe Skate America host pick. Maybe. But anyways, Tomoki Hiwatashi. It's my personal favorite. Did you get a chance to watch him?
I did, yeah. The Pewter Medal is nothing to laugh about, really. He should be really proud of himself on that. And this guy has a lot of potential. And I think that if I were, I'm going to get slaughtered for saying this, but if I were Vincent Joe, I would be watching out especially because Tomoki can do quads and he gets around. And if that's the name of the game going forward, as far as United States Nationals goes, Tomoki can make a run for the money right now. Because we know that Jason is very consistent. He can land all his jumps and he has the program components. But if Tomoki can stay this way and land quads for the next 3 years, he could be really much of a dark horse to getting on that world championships team. And even potentially an Olympics team. So hopefully this does not go to his head, but I see a lot of potential in him as well. And it was great to see him deliver those performances because I think before, I would never have even put him as a Pewter medalist if I was to do a predictions video with you because I did not really know too much of him. Mm-hmm. But it would be great if he gets a host pick for Skate America next season just to get more experience. And to give him that drive to really perform at Nationals and compete internationally for the United States.
Yeah, you bring up a good point by saying Vincent Joe should be worried. And that's actually true because I don't think Tomoki's jump style is as prone to under rotations as Vincent's is. And as I said, he usually gets rotation. And from what I can see is something's very special about him. He grits out the landings. They're not always pretty, whereas I think Vincent is more prone to under rotations and falling. You lose some GOE points, but you do get the base value. So I do think you make a good point there. So, yay! And then there is Alexei Krasnozon. Am I saying it right?
I don't think so. I think it's Kuroshov. I don't know. We all have someone correct us, but he competed for Russia, I believe, right? I think he was the one
when
that
he was
competed
younger.
For Russia.
Mm-hmm.
When he was younger, yep. It was not his best skate, though. But I think a lot of like the men after fourth really struggled. It was almost like a fifth and down were like pretty much lackluster, to say the least.
No, that's right. I was just surprised with this performance from Alexei. Like, he did enough to place fifth, you know. You should see some of the other men at Nationals.
Yeah.
But it's also rebuilding season for him. He's had some injury. I think he excelled as a junior last season, you know, winning the junior Grand Prix final. And I watched him as a junior, and I found a lot of things about his skating, not just the jumps, really pleasant to watch. This season, it's like it's all off of whack. Like, you know, the way he strokes is a little different. I think there might be some growing pains as well, because he does look a little taller. So I'm gonna refrain from using the word potential. But, you know, he has landed the quad many times in the past. How his future looks, we'll see.
Yeah, but to his own credit, like, I'm glad that he came to Nationals, because I know, I think last season he was scheduled to compete at Junior Worlds, and he was the favorite. And this is the one that trained with Kane, right? Peter Kane? Yeah, so he was scheduled to compete at World Junior Championships and was the favorite to win the gold medal, but then he injured himself and had to come back. So, as you said, Justin, it could be a rebuilding year for him. And all you can do is wish him the best and come back strong, because he had all that potential to be that World Junior Champion last season. And it just wasn't in his cards.
That's right. So next up, we have Tim Delensky, who's been at Nationals quite a few times, has had some international experience in the past. I do like his skating quality is there, good performer. When the jumps are on, they're really good, triple axel. Man, he had some rotation issues in the free program. I think he wants to redo this competition, because he is capable of a lot more, and especially with the field being what it is this year after the third placement, you know, he really could have been fighting for that pewter medal over Tomoki. But, you know, I wouldn't count him out in the future. Just, you know, he's had better showings at Nationals than this, although actually similar results.
Yeah, I think it's a mental thing for Tim Delensky. I know we've been talking about him for years now, and all that great possibilities for him. And for some reason, when it comes to U.S. Nationals, he gets tight and is prone to making mistakes after mistakes. And like, he'll always qualify for Nationals based on his skating quality and his performances at smaller competitions. But if you want to make the world team or get more international assignments, it is all about delivering at U.S. Nationals. So,
which puts the pressure on skaters.
Yeah, definitely. And we're not skaters, Justin. Like, we're not competitive ice skaters. So, this is just coming from a good place, and I am a fan of his as well. But it seems like when he comes to U.S. Nationals, something about him just, like, he gets tight. And that makes him make more mistakes.
You're right, Kanishka. You bring up a good point. We're just fans. A lot of times I get the question, what do you think this skater should have done? What do you think this skater should have done? My answer is always the same. You know that. It's like, I'm not part of their training team. They know what's best. Their team knows what's best. Maybe they had the right idea, but how, you know, you don't know until you try. You know, it's easy for us to say what should have happened afterwards, you know? But exactly. You know, it's like, I put the trust in the skater and their team. So whatever they chose, you know, to skate, to withdraw, that's on them. So anyone else you wanted to mention? I know Sean Rabbit had a top 10 finish here. He's always a crowd pleaser. You want to see one of his programs? The short was super clean. That was really impressive. Got a personal best. Long program, definitely had some struggles, but it was a Sean Rabbit that everybody loves.
Agreed. I think it's great that you're giving him a shout out, especially because he is one of our friends, Josh Kennan's favorites, and he's always going to be a showstopper. And when those programs are clean, he really lights up an audience. And I think he skates for the right reason. He skates because he loves it, and it really shows. And he's like a skater in that sense.
That's right.
Looking forward to just watching him as long as he's competing, because he does bring the audience to its feet when he's clean. So
yeah, I will quote my friend Autumn Wolf on Twitter. So she said she thought to herself, Sean doesn't have a triple axel or a quad. what is he doing? But then she looks at him and she's like, oh, wait, he skates for the right reasons. I was like, boom, yeah, you're right.
There you go. I don't even know who this Autumn is.
Yeah, right? And then there is Emmanuel Savory, who I believe finished 11th here. So I always want to give him a shout out for bringing some much needed diversity into the sport.
Quad, by the way. Beautiful.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Quad.
The long program, Quad Sao Cow, was whew.
So I really hope that he realizes that he has a lot of fan support here. You know, like, we were, like, talking about him, like, for, like, every Nationals and a preview or recap, whichever one you ever had me on, you know, because we see a lot of great in him. And if he can continue to get, like, all the other jumps consistent, really, I hope United States Figure Skating starts prepping him up, because I would love to see United States Figure Skating prep up Star and Emmanuel and really get other people that may not have been interested in figure skating before to get on the ice. Because I think when I see those commercials about, like, train, I don't know what that commercial is, you know, like, go skate or whatever it is, that campaign, like, I really want to, like, be, like, motivated to, like, go and, like, start skating. And this will, having, if you give them the opportunity to really make a name for themselves, I feel like you will be getting a lot more out of the sport. So
yeah,
I totally agree with you, Justin.
And I think his raw skating is actually getting better. So it's about the jumps improving. And it was actually kind of nice to see that the audience also really liked him too. I heard a lot of like shouts and woos for him. So Emmanuel Savory, if you're watching this, you have a lot of love. Anyone else you wanted to talk about? I'm great.
That's pretty much it, yeah.
Okay, so let's move on to ladies. Wow, you can't talk about ladies at 2019 U.S. National Championships without mentioning the name Alyssa Liu, who has now officially broken the record for the youngest ladies U.S. National Champion at just 13. This past season did not even qualify due to her age for any junior Grand Prix events, so she'll compete under her first junior Grand Prix this upcoming season. And how did she win the title? By skating three cleanly called triple axels, one in the short, two in the free. Wow.
Wow is the word, yep. And this just never happens. I think that's what Terry Gannon was saying, you know, this just never happens.
I'll mention the obvious. So yay, triple axel. She's so happy. Like, she's skating for the right reason. Of course, she's 13. Joy obviously needs to work on skating skills, but that's really not something I'm gonna like fuss on too much here. She's 13. I know some people were complaining that she's so young. Should she have competed as a senior? But you know, other like ladies have skated senior at her age in the past, so that's not the thing. I mean, if she's able to bring it, you know, with the veterans, go for it. But yeah, just great. Obviously needs to rebuild some of her skating. I can't believe it's either impressive or concerning that she's so slow sometimes going into that triple axel. Like, wow, imagine gaining some speed into that. But I think, yeah.
She also pre-rotates a little bit.
Mm-hmm. No, I've heard that too.
Yeah, so it is a triple axel. A triple axel is a triple axel, but she does pre-rotate a little bit. And but she's 13. She's 13. Mm-hmm. So I'm being nitpicky.
That's right. Okay, when you're the champion, we have to be nitpicky. And then what else is there? I know there's a lot of discussion on the fact that we shouldn't place too much pressure on her right now. And I am totally behind that. Like, let's celebrate her accomplishments. Let's cool it with our expectations. I know, was it Terry Gannon being like, look out Russians, look out Japanese. I was like, whoa, can we calm down? I mean, this girl was in tears after her long program for the right reasons. Let's not pull a Mariah Nagasu 2009 and have her skate the long program in tears from the beginning. Like, this girl, we need to keep her skating for fun as long as possible. So I mean, that's just my final take on Alyssa Liu.
I agree. Yeah, putting too much attention on a skater that is so fragile at this age, you know, at 13, like, it's like a growing age for a lot of young women and young men as well. And they can go through a lot of emotions, you know? So, like, I totally see why there should not be so much pressure on her. Like, let's celebrate her accomplishments, as you said, Justin, but let's take it one day at a time, really. So then when the time comes for the 2022 Olympic Games, she will be ready, not just physically, but also, like, mentally, because she does have all that potential to bring home an Olympic gold medal. But knock on wood somewhere.
That's right. Well, let's talk about who a lot of people thought should have won this competition or who could have won this competition. Brady Tennell, it is hard, let me tell you, to defend your title at nationals, especially in the United States. We need to learn from some other countries. It's a hard thing to do, especially in ladies. But Brady Tennell was not able to do it. Lost the competition by about 5 points from Alyssa Liu. Obviously, Alyssa gained the points with the triple axels. Brady was not clean. I mean, that free program, triple lutz, triple loop, yes, it's a very difficult jump, was not clean, fell on a triple lutz, which was under rotation, which means she couldn't get in a combination, only did two combinations, and they weren't executed perfectly either. It was really unfortunate, and I think with that, her program component marks were lowered as well. So if you ask me, I think maybe Brady Tennell lost the title, because Alyssa Liu, she wasn't in first after the short.
Yeah, like, I honestly feel like Brady did not have... Okay, so Brady had pressure, but she did not have pressure in the free skate because she skated before Alyssa did, you know? Like, I always feel like it would have been a different story if Alyssa skated before Brady and then delivered the same performance and then Brady had to go on the ice. But, again, like, I don't know what an athlete kind of goes through the minutes before they go... take the starting pose of for their performance. So it looked like Brady was doubting herself. And usually Brady does not doubt herself. And we saw that last season when she came out Skate America. We saw it like that she was fearless. At U.S. Nationals, she was fearless. So again, like, this is the hardest competition to defend. And it has been for as long as we could, like, talk about skating, you know, like with Michelle Kwan, Tara Lipinski, so forth and so forth, you know? So I think it's a mental thing more than a physical thing for Brady. And good lesson learned for her that maybe wanting it too much will cause her to make mistakes. But she is right now our top lady in, as far as who can compete as a in the senior division.
Internationally.
Internationally, yeah. So hopefully... she'll be able to pull through two performances at Worlds that will allow us to either regain three spots or at least maintain two spots. But optimistically speaking, three. And yeah, that's heartbreaking, really. Even though I'm not a huge, but I'm a huge Brady Tennell fan, it was kind of heartbreaking to see her struggle.
Yeah, so this is a good opportunity to talk about this topic regarding Brady Tennell. I think NBC or some news outlet came out with an article saying that Brady was branded as the girl with consistency when she first won her title. And she was, based on all the commentators, and I don't think that was rightfully so. So I don't blame Brady. It's not her fault. It's the commentators or reporters' fault. I don't even think it's the fans' fault. I think a lot of us are pretty realistic. Well, some people I keep myself close to are pretty realistic with figure skating. You know, you can't call someone consistent just because they had two clean competitions, one being nationals or three, you know, like, yeah, she won Skate America. She won a medal at Skate America last season, the bronze, when Ashley Wagner pulled out of the long program. Yes, she did win that nationals. Yes, she did go to the Olympics and Worlds and did okay. We really saw her struggling this season, and I think it was too soon to call her Ms. Consistent. You know, give her two Grand Prix. Let's see how she does then. Then we can brand her based on her results as a senior internationally.
Definitely.
All right. So Mariah Bell, another fan favorite, she was able to win the bronze medal. Kudos to her. Always enjoyable to watch her skate. I mean, if anything, I think she's actually growing artistically. I'm thinking back to when she first came on the scene with Titanic, the free program, and I even really like that. And she's just grown so much since then. The jumps just need work. But she's on Team Raph. I'm pretty sure he has a long-term plan for her. Not going for some of the more difficult triple-triples or any triple-triple in the free program, really. She does a double axle triple-toe. Let's toe, I think that's her favorite combination to go for. Oof, that doesn't have a good track record with the rotation of the toe.
Always so enjoyable. And if I break down the program components, I think if Mariah just landed that one jump, the triple lutz that she fell on, I think she would have still been national champion if she could have just landed that jump. It could have gone the same way, but I feel like had Mariah skated clean, I think she would have won the national title based on the performances that were ahead of her.
Yeah, and so, Mariah, her PCS were just like a sliver above Brady. But, you know, maybe if Mariah was totally clean with difficult content, the judges could pump that up to be higher.
Agreed.
Oh, don't yawn. We're not done. I was just joking. So, you know who is really exciting, though? The pewter medalist here, Hannah Harrell. Ooh, that is a young girl with spunk. Short program and long program. She actually has really good jump technique, like nice height, nice distance. Ooh, I've been listening to too much Tara Lipinski. Sorry. She has a technique down, doesn't look like she's too prone to under rotations. She really, all she has to do is work on her actual performance, which comes with time. I think she's 15 or 16, but ooh, did you see her skating?
I did, yeah. She has a lot of great grit on those triple-triple combinations that she attempts. And prior to US Nationals, I did not know who she was. I have to be honest, I did not know who she was.
Same here.
But she really did make a name for herself at these Nationals. And if she can have that stable technique going forward, like she really does have the basics under control right now. And if she can bring some more performance and maturity on the ice, I think that she could get third next year if she can maintain this.
That's right. And we have to remember, a lot of these skaters are really making the most of the opportunity at Nationals with some of the veterans not attending, most notably Ashley Wagner, Mariah Nagasu. We had some withdrawals like Angela Wang and some other ones. So really, these skaters like Hannah Harrell and Ting Sui, who finished fifth, really stepping up their game. And speaking of Ting, wow, that free program. That let's triple toe. If she, I ask of all American ladies, if you can do one thing cleanly international, it's a let's and toe. Please keep it that way.
Yeah, she has that the vintage show, like triple let's and then rip on triple toe. So yeah, that gets higher grades of execution. She has a beautiful quality on the ice. Whenever I think of the music of Giselle, I think of a blue dress, but hey, you can't always get what you want.
You make better decisions as you get older, don't worry.
I thought it was just one lake or something, but nope, it was Giselle. She has really great technique, and she will be going to four continents, Justin, right? So she'll definitely be able to make a name for herself there.
So I also think this is an appropriate time to talk about what USFSA is doing with their selections for Junior Worlds. So for the men's and the ladies, there will apparently be a Junior World pre-camp where six skaters are invited, and then the three skaters per each discipline will be decided. The three skaters that will represent Team USA at Junior Worlds will be decided after the camp. So we'll see who gets a chance to impress us at Junior Worlds whenever that happens.
Very different way of doing it, but hey, I like the idea. But
it sounds like a lot of skating fans have the same consensus, which is that's different, that's odd and unique, but go for it.
I feel like we should be doing that with the senior ones
too. Yeah, right. But you know, maybe they're working towards building up the younger generation. Any other female skaters you'd like to mention?
No, but build up the current generation too.
Yeah, I don't have much of a comment on anybody else. I think, I don't want to be mean and call out people who didn't do as well as I thought they would. But look at the results. There's many people I could be talking about on to dance. So,
my favorite discipline.
I really wish we had Nicole or Aaron on with us, but we will have to make up for it somehow. Madison Hubble and Zachary Donahue got to defend their title successfully.
So the thing about this team, I know everyone loves them for the most part, and I think a lot of people don't understand Romeo and Juliet, but I actually kind of like this take on Romeo and Juliet as the season progressed, because it's like a mature love, you know? It's not the story of Romeo and Juliet that everyone knows, which is the young kids that fall in love and then blah, 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 blah. Like, I feel like this is a more of a... I think this is the story of Maddie and Zach, really. Because they used to once date when they were younger. And they had to skate with one another. And then they broke up. And then now they have two significant others that are not their partners. So I think that this is more of a story about Maddie and Zach more than the story of Romeo and Juliet. But at the end of the day, I think they love each other as far as, like, skating partners go, you know? Mm-hmm. And I think that's kind of what the storyline of this free dance really is. But I don't. It's not everyone's favorite, and I think there's going to be a lot of discussion on that.
I was going to say, a lot of people don't agree with you.
I already knew that. But yeah. I wanted to make that clear that there's probably more to this story than just... it's Romeo and Juliet.
Yeah, I will say, a lot of people ask my opinion in the past, I think what makes the free program great is how they execute it. You know, the program itself, but you know, it's really great because of what they do with the program. And I was actually thinking about this. My opinion, at least for the singles disciplines, maybe even pairs a little bit, but more so the singles, is that maybe it doesn't matter what the program is, as long as you skate clean, that can make a big difference. But I actually think with ice dance, the actual program you choose, like the music, is actually a pivotal part of doing well.
Agreed. And just, I just need to move my computer a little bit.
Yeah, that's fine. I'll talk as you move. So, okay. Moving on, I think, so Madison Hubble, Zachary Donahue had a comfortable win here. 2015 was their total score. Madison Chalk and Evan Bates came in second with 2:11. In the silver medal position. So, you know, there's, you know, a few points difference between those two. But I will say that Madison Chalk and Evan Bates were kind of the surprise here. And actually, their free dance seemed to be more of a fan favorite than the one by Madison Hubble and Zachary Donahue.
Agreed. Yeah. I saw that on the tweet, like the Twitter feed, and also just the comments on the YouTube videos that people have posted. Mm-hmm. That Madison Chalk and Evan Bates' program was more well received. And it kind of makes sense too, because the performance, it's kind of two total contrasts of programs. You know, yeah. There's like the lyrical program that Madison Hubble and Zach Donahue do, and then the one that Madison Chalk and Evan Bates do is a little bit more of the showy type of program, you know? So it is a contrast of flavors for some people, and some people like the sweet, and some people like the spicy. So it kind of goes back to that analogy in some ways.
That's right. Well, spicy works really well on Madison Chalk. And Evan Bates, but really Madison Chalk. Ooh, she was hungry in the rhythm dance, in the free dance. Wow, they came back with a bang. And just as Madison Hubble said in an interview earlier, she said that training with them in Montreal, she knew that their free dance really suited their personality and their chemistry as a couple on the ice, because in the past that's been off the ice. And I absolutely agree. They look like some people in love when they're skating. And I gotta say, like, I think their skating's getting better. I think I see, like, a light of excitement that hasn't always been there for this particular dance team in the past. Technically speaking, I think they really sold me on the second half of the free dance, where the lifts came in. Those were some extremely difficult curves lifts they did. And as Tanith said in her commentary, one of the most difficult in the whole competition. Like, wow, that was really good. Took practice, took strength, took skill. But also we have to note that it did slow down their speed a little bit. But you know, you got to sacrifice something to gain something for them. But yeah, kudos. It looked like in the kiss and cry they were expecting to win, because they weren't too happy with the silver medal. I'm not sure how I feel about that, but I'd say I'm glad that they at least got the silver to show that they were still competitive despite being away from competition for some time.
Yeah, it looks like they're having like a resurgence this season, you know, like even Evan looks a lot more youthful in some ways. Mm-hmm. So it looks like they're kind of going back in time, you know, in some ways, you know, like they're peaking or they're starting a new peak in many ways, you know, so.
Or maybe they're continuing to skate for the right reasons.
Maybe, and maybe in years past they were thinking more about the titles and now they're skating for the sake of just enjoying every moment mm-hmm. and showcasing the love for one another, you know?
That's so, right. Skating in Montreal must be something special for American ice dancers because, you know, that's where everyone's training now, including the bronze medalists here, Caitlin Hawayek and John Luke Baker. That always throws me off with the spelling. So they did as well as expected here to win the bronze. I think the biggest word I use to describe them, which not everybody loves, is that they're cute. But not only are they cute to look up, they're really growing as a dance team. They're really smoothing out their elements, and they're really growing together. I'm so proud of all they accomplished this season, including winning NHK Trophy, qualifying for the Grand Prix Final in Vancouver. And, you know, they were kind of expected to be third here, but they skated to third place with, you know, class and beauty, and I really think they're the future of ice dance.
I think so too. Yeah, I saw them at U.S. Nationals last season when I attended in San Jose, and it was almost like they were floating on clouds. And that's kind of how I described it. I don't know if anyone else described
there
it.
There is a light quality to their skating, so that's true.
And that's impressive because if you can make something look light and effortless on the ice, then you're doing something right. So,
because let me tell you something, ice dance is hard.
Ice dance is hard. Actually, any skating is hard. So to make it look that easy is a great quality to have. And they're so young and they're hungry. And winning a bronze medal here and going to the World Championships this season, I think it's definitely they're heading in the right direction. And I know they were, I think Jean-Luc was injured for some of the season as well. So what better time to really step up their game than at U.S. Nationals and now go to the World Championships. So congratulations to them.
That's right. And really what was the most exciting part about U.S. Ice Dance at Nationals this year in Detroit was the battle for the pewter medal. Aaron and I did a preview video for dance, and yep, we listed all the possibilities. But when it came down to the actual competition, it looked like the pewter was between Lorraine McNamara and Quinn Carpenter, or Christina Carrier and Anthony Ponomarenko. And their scores were close, but Lorraine and Quinn edged out for the win. And I'm happy because I think they were also at Skate America.
They were.
Yeah, and I tweeted they gave me Tessa and Scott vibes. So I personally like them. Yes, they need to grow. Like, spare me all of that. I like watching them. So
they have a lot of fan support. They have a lot of fan support. Like, I remember, like, when I was at U.S. Nationals, one of my friends, Vicky Horton, if you are friends with her or she's watching here, hello. she told me a lot about this team and how they have all this great potential to be a great team and a top team. And I see it now. Like, the fact that we were able to see them live at Skate America, Justin, really, like, showed me exactly what this team is all about. And they're still very young as well. And they got international assignments this season. And who knows? Like, the shift of U.S. ice dance can change very quickly. We saw that with Tanith Melman and Ben Augusto. And then Meryl and Charlie just came on the scene and then took over. So we never know exactly where the field of ice dance will go. So they'll be really pushing towards, like, the bronze medal next season. So very exciting stuff.
Ice dance is the discipline to really be Team USA and internationally.
There you go, journalists. Pay attention to ice dance again.
Do it. So, Kanishka, I think we are done. My timer says we've been talking for over an hour. Like, wow. Apparently, we had a lot to discuss. In the beginning, I was like, you know, let's not do a rundown of the results, just discussion. And I think we talked about almost everything. So thank you so much for being on my video. Again, thank you everyone who watched and who made it this far. And I'll catch you in my next one. Goodbye.
Bye.